कर रहा हूँ।
You have to be very careful. You know what is happening nowadays in this second of webinar. Two incidents have already caught the attention of everybody.
We are live now. Welcome to Ortho TV ORF web class. And to introduce today's program and speaker, I hand over to the chairman, Dr. John Mukhopadhyay.
Thank you, Neeraj, and good evening, everybody. Today is a pleasure for me to introduce Dr. Rajagopalan Iyer from Pondicherry. I think I know Rajagopalan for a long time. We were together in Jipma, Pondicherry. I think it feels like so many years ago. It's actually in the 70s. So you can imagine that's almost 50 years ago. And we've been in touch off and on since then. But we all know he's a great academic. It's since Jipma, he's been in St. John's Medical College, back to Pondicherry, back to Bangalore, and now he's back in Pondicherry in the Pondicherry Institute of Medical Sciences. And he runs many academic courses, especially for postgraduates. And it's a pleasure for us to have him here today to talk to us about clinical examination of the spine. I'm sure all the DNB students will learn a great deal from his deliberations today. And hopefully we'll have lots of times for questions at the end. So over to you, Dr. Rajagopalan.
Thank you, John. Thanks a lot for the good words. It's been a really a privilege for me to be invited by you and talk on this forum, which is something which I consider great luck for me. And now, anyway, thanks to you all. Thanks to the Orthopedic Research and Education Foundation, of which you are the chairman. To all my dear postgraduates who have taken the time off missing the test match and hearing me, thank you. And I hope it benefits you. That's the most important thing. For the final year residents or even second year residents, I'm sure there's going to be nothing new. It may be more of a refresher course. I really will be happy if the first year residents benefit a bit from my talk. I'll be covering most of the basics, and within the time stipulated to me of 30 minutes, naturally, I won't be able to tell what all I want to tell. That will go on for hours given a chance. So I'll be concentrating on something and going slow on some aspects, which I think will be useful for you, both from the practical point of view and exam point of view. Exams do come and go. Patients do come, but they won't go if they won't come back again if we don't do a proper job. So some of the practical things which I will be useful to you, and I'm sure that nothing is going to be new for you. Whatever I have put, I have just kept to the standard, available literature, so that you will not suffer because of any wrong information from me.
They won't come back.
Can I proceed?
Sir.
I heard something. Now, I am going to talk on clinical examination.
Please share the slides. Please share, sir.
Oh, I have not shared. Huh? Okay, sorry. Sorry. Okay, just a minute. Because I already shared it before, I completely forgot. Just give me a minute. As a routine, since I thought already shared, so no problem. Okay, sorry. That's a foolish mistake. All right.
Yeah, that's good now.
I had shared it earlier, so by that, this thing. So anyway, all that what I said is still relevant. So when any of us talk to you on this, we always tell you, follow your protocol, be systematic. And this is really very, very important, because in the exam tension, you will forget what all you know otherwise. Unless otherwise, you are used to doing it regularly. If you think that only on the exam day, I will examine the patient thoroughly, other days I will do a random job, believe me, it doesn't work for you or me. So this is something we all tell you, and it's very, very important that you follow a systematic approach. Why? This is not only for spine, not only for hip, not only for any subject, whichever, not only for orthopedics, anywhere. Spine is different, because in all the steps, unlike a hip or something, we have a very important step of neurological examination. So when you do the systematic one, you go through a good history, good inspection, neurology, Then comes the most important. You have to interpret all these things, come to some kind of understanding so that you come to a right diagnosis. If you miss one step, let me say that you are not taking a proper history or you did a poor neurology, then you are going to be totally wrong in your diagnosis because you have not correlated well. And at the end of the day, when you have examination, clinical examination only a part of it, then you're going to give your personal diagnosis. If it's relevant, you are going to give your differential diagnosis. Examiner may ask you, how do you differentiate? How do you manage? Management, you will give options and what you do, what you want to do, you will tell. But all this, believe me, is theory. Finally, the step is your clinical examination. If your diagnosis is wrong, all the other things, diagnosis can be wrong, it doesn't matter. But if your clinical examination findings are wrong, your diagnosis will be wrong. If your diagnosis is right, exam findings are wrong, it doesn't have a value. But you have examined thoroughly with the findings that you got, you cannot make a diagnosis, you can give a differential, nothing wrong with it. So I'm just stressing again, a systematic approach is very, very important. Now coming to the examination per se, the most important thing is knowledge of anatomy, whichever the part of orthopedics or any subject. But spine, it is extremely important. So a subject which anatomy of that area is beyond the purview of this talk, please, please, you have to keep refreshing. I also have to keep refreshing because we can't remember. The spine, why the important? This diagram you will spine in any spine talk doing with the disc. So if you have a L4, L5 disc, this anatomy will explain why a L4 root can't be involved and a L5 root is involved. So everything depends on anatomy. So please refresh your anatomy. Now, coming to clinical examination, the steps are like anything, everywhere else. You'll have a history, the general examination, gait, inspection, etc., etc. But the difference is that not only the neurology, special test, secular joints, at the end of your examination, you will have had a diagnosis. It may be relevant for you to think, should I go back to neurology again? I don't do a routine cranial nerves. It may be relevant. In a tuberculosis cervical spine, you can have a cranial nerve involvement, glossopharyngeal nerve involvement. So you'll have to think of that. And general examination, your diagnosis, tuberculosis, there may be abscesses. You might not have looked for that. So if time permits you, you have to look that also. Now, history in spine is something little different because if I am going to take the history, I will divide it into three areas so that I don't miss out anything. For example, let's say my case is a tuberculosis of this dorsal spine with the cord compression. So first is the pathology part, tuberculosis. So I will concentrate on the history of what are the features which should be there for me to say tuberculosis. And then if it is some other DD, they may ask me why it can't be malignancy. For example, what are the things I should ask for in depression diagnosis? This tuberculosis or trauma, whatever the pathology. So area of involvement, dorsal spine. So I will ask about the pain relevant to that area, whatever is involvement, for example, the deformities, your pain, and other factors relevant to the thing. Third is the complication, neurology history about bladder bubble. That may be the most important thing. You are, unless the bladder is distended or patient is not able to fully conscious, you can't do any other way. It's difficult to make out. So history is very, very important. You'll have to ask about loss of sensation, lot of motor power, difficulty in ambulation, all those things. So history can be divided into three areas. And I'm not going to details of all that. General, like any other case, general symptoms, local systems, specific to the area of involvement, leading questions, and negative history of disease. That's the three things. Now, there are a few things important. The location of pain, we'll come to that later, why it is important. Onset of pain, mechanism of injury, diurnal variation, prior history, aggravating factors, activity changes. Now, what about the location? See, spine, unlike, let me say, a hip joint, you know, it can be referred to the knee, etc. Spine, the patient cannot really specifically locate. He will say usually back, etc., unless you specifically ask. Second thing is about the radiation of pain. To know that, you should have an idea of about a myotome and dermatome for evaluation. And if you are handling a peripheral nerve, let me say you are having a femoral nerve, a sciatic nerve, or a common peroneal nerve, should have an idea of the root level origin. Then is the symptom static? To know whether the disease is static or the lesion is static, or is it progressive, or is there is a set of exacerbations, remissions. Exacerbation and remission will make you think of a chronic inflammatory disease. So these are all important things. I am not going into details about the pain, type of pain, all these things. I'm only telling you what is important you should ask. I'm sorry. Other than this, a smoking and drinking habits and occupation, what it involves is important. In a practical sense, more than the exam, exam also is important. But a patient coming to you, if you end up your management has to suit what he wants, what is his occupation, what is his needs. Smoking has got many things, not only, for example, if it's a fracture or a union or a fusion, all this in a chronic smokers are a problem. You all know that. So that is one thing. So you many people are afraid of taking up a major spine surgery when the patient is a very chronic smoker. The drinking habits, you know the relevance for that. I'm not going to do that. But leaving all that aside, you have taken a history, you have presented, then usually we ask you, okay, from the history that you are seeing, what do you think your problem is? You don't say that you give a diagnosis like, say, disc prolapse with this. No. We're asking basically, are you handling a traumatic problem, inflammatory problem, infective problem? You give a perfect diagnosis, tuberculosis with cord compression and paraplegia, etc. But ask him why. How do you justify that? You are not able to justify. So whenever you give a perfect diagnosis, not able to justify, first thing we are afraid. You are all DNB students. You go to another center. But in MS center, we where MS exam is held, we think that they know the case. So it's always better that you don't know the case and don't be biased. So when you give a diagnosis in the history, give only a generalized one, not exactly one, unless otherwise you have reason to say that. Now coming to examination proper, general examination and local examination. I am not going to go to general examination at all. You all know that to lock up time. Now the examination starts with gait. Gait is not only in hip joint that you start with the gait, you think of it in lumbar. It is there for anything. You get even a foot drop patient, gait is important. So it is part of the thing, and spine there is importance too. A cervical myelopathy patient walks with a wide base gait. A patient with a proximal myopathy will have a Wadding gait. If it's a one side only, can even have a lumbar gait. So you have to have examined the gait, and you must see the patient walking. It is not just for this alone. As I told you, there are many reasons. You can have antalgic gait, you have a lumbar gait, you can have a short leg due to some other associated cause, or you can have a foot drop. It could be a root problem, could be a peripheral nerve problem, but all this is possible. So I'm not the examination of gait is a separate topic by itself. Separate rhomba, that is the first step. Why beginning? One, it is that you will not forget, number one. Number two, you will also know the patient is able to walk or not. So you will know how to examine him. He may not be able to stand and all those things. Then coming to inspection, when you are examining the spine, it's like everywhere else. You have to examine him in the standing position, supine position, and sitting position, supine position, and prone position. What are the things you look for? Depends. When the patient is standing, there may be a list. Patient may be leaning away from the nerve root management side to the opposite side to give relief of pain. You look for scoliosis, you look for kyphosis, you look for lordosis. I'll come to that step by step. But before all that, when we look for any obvious swellings, because for example, that might be an abscess or there might be other things, look for any obvious swelling and surgical scars. Patient has been operated, you have an idea about it. Then look for the normal body points, like the shoulder level, pelvic tilt. One thing, a muscular spasm is something more easily seen than even palpated. And spasm is an important feature of many conditions, maybe an acute dislocation or even tuberculosis. One of the important features of tuberculosis of any joint is spasm. And also, don't forget, muscle spasm wasting. It can be seen even in gluteal region, even in the back. Other than this, you are not likely to get a case like this in the examination, but just for knowing the importance of inspection, what the person you see in the picture, if you see a person from behind like this, you have a low hairline and you have a short neck and you see the scapula at a higher level, what do you call that? sprengel shoulder or an undescended scapula or a high scapula, the diagnosis is a Klippel-Feil syndrome. You take an X-ray, you will find a fusion of cervical vertebrae. The diagnosis is confirmed. So just by looking at him, the diagnosis is sure. So inspection is very, very important if you know what to look for. Before you start your complete examination, sometime a minimal deformity, like for example, a minimal kyphotic deformity of the dorsal spine, or there could be even opposites, absence of the cervical lordosis. Some minimal deformities can be unmasked by a simple thing. Make the patient stand close to the wall with the back straight. And at that time, in a normal patient, the occiput, shoulders, gluteal region, and the heels, they will be in contact with the wall. So with just observing, you will unmask the deformities. Then you know what to examine. That's all. It's not that this is for the thing, but it gives you an idea so you can save time when you come to the particular spine. To know that, you should know the normal anatomy, cervical lordosis, thoracic kyphosis, and lumbar lordosis. I'm not going into that. As I said, anatomy is something we won't have time. So unlikely you will get a case in the exam with a complete posterior costophyteal spine involving all the spines. Unlikely, but the examiner can still ask you, we have a tuberculosis with a localized gibbous, he can still ask you, what are the conditions, sir? You remember that the commonest condition in India, where you see, even today I saw a lady walking with almost 90 degrees or 100 degree of kyphosis, like a yell, and I felt so bad for her to see it on the road today. It is so, so sad that in spite of so much advance, we are not able to prevent a totally curable condition or preventable condition. So a senile kyphosis, the commonest thing in India is an osteoporosis, a postmenopausal and plus senile osteoporosis, what you call a senile kyphosis. It's a very, very common thing. So whole spine is kyphotic, that is the commonest one. Then it could be osteomalacia, a Schumann's disease, which is osteochondritis involving the vertebrae, or ankylosing spondylitis. As you know, you have a major problem because they can't see what is coming in front. So these are common conditions. But if a localized area is involved, there are three things that should come to your mind. Tuberculosis spine, even today is a common thing in our country, it's a number of things come. Where tuberculosis is uncommon, it could be congenital or fractures of the spine. They call a local area. I'm not going to different types of these. These are all known to you right from your undergraduate days. But what you commonly miss is the lumbar spine. The lumbar spine, there's a normal lumbar lordosis. This could be reversed. Okay, like there can be a straight lumbar spine indicating a spasm, or in some cases, even that may go into a somewhat a kyphotic deformity. Even when the kyphosis is more, it overcomes that. Or the lumbar lordosis can be more. So you should have an idea. So example, you see a patient in the OPD with a severe loss of lumbar lordosis, a straight lumbar spine. You will have to think it's acute. You will have to think of a lumbar spasm due to a disc prolapse. Or if it is a chronic one, the commonest is probably tuberculosis spine. Pyogenic spondylitis is not so common. Of course, probably we have missed it a lot in the past, but it's still not so common. And the second, probably the more common than that is ankylosing spondylitis. Quite often, we'll be surprised that in the early stages, we all miss it. Increased lumbar lordosis could be completely normal, especially in women, especially those who are wearing the high heel. And if you leave that out, in a listhesis, if you're somebody coming with estrated lordosis, one of the things you should think of a listhesis or a compensatory one. Patient is having a kyphosis like you saw in the earlier due to a kyphotic dorsal spine. He has to compensate with the increased lordosis. Or a common thing which you see in the hip joint, if FFD patient obliterates or patient masks the deformity with a compensatory increase in lordosis. So these are the conditions where the lumbar lordosis will be more. Now, coming to examining the patient, as I already said, look at where there's a list, then look at a scoliosis. At that stage itself, when you are doing that, ask the patient to bend forward and touch the floor. As the patient bends forward, if the scoliosis disappears, it's a postural one. If the scoliosis is structural, the deformity will persist and a rib hump will come up. And you see the rib hump, if the deformity is obvious, then it is a structural one. This is what is called Adam's test, which is normally used for a school screening, very easy test. So at this level, if you do that, so you know that you don't miss it. Other than scoliosis, look for shoulder tilt and pelvic tilt. This is going to be important, particularly in a deformity. Previously, we were not keeping deformity cases. Now, particularly in DNB, a scoliosis can be kept as a short case for you. Other than this, what you see so superficially, and that's very, very important. It may not be a spine case. It may be a child with equino varus deformity. You might think it is a congenital talpus equinovarus. It may not be. There could be associated spine problem, which is not very clear, very seen. Obviously, it is a spina bifida occulta. And there are some telltale signs of spina bifida occulta, which all of you, I'm sure, know very well. There could be four things: a tuft of hair, or a pad of fat, or a swelling, a dimple, or a hyperpigmented area. So these four things you should know. Other than that, look for sinus and scars indicating old healed problem. A cafe LA spot. This examiner's favorite question, if it is there, what is the cafe LA spot? What are the conditions you get it? Neurofibroma and fibro dysplasia. What is the difference between both? All those things commonly asked. And some scar, already mentioned about the scar. Other than this, other swellings. It could be swelling. It could be an abscess there, or there are other causes too. And abnormal creases. And another important thing, we always talk about wasting of the glutein, hamstring and calf muscles in the hip. Same thing can be there. If there is a neurology deficit, these muscles also will be atrophic. So don't miss them. So you should look for wasting of the muscles too. Some picture example, for those who have not seen cafe LA spot, it used to be so very common, as Dr. John said, in our earlier days in Pondicherry. The neurofibroma was so common. You can just go on the road and you can see the multiple neurofibromatosis plexiform type. So the cafe LA spots is something you should not miss. So in a spinal case, cafe LA spot associated with scoliosis, then we know this scoliosis due to neurofibromatosis. This is a patient again, which I saw in St. John's with scoliotic deformity and neurofibromatosis. Then coming to the four things we talked about in the spine for a spina bifida occulta. Please remember, I think all of you know what is spina bifida occulta. A spina bifida is divided into spina bifida anterior and posterior. It is not that spina bifida is only posterior. Anterior is very, very rare, and I have not seen one, and probably more difficult to find out. But posterior is very common. Spina bifida occulta, as already said, it could be a tuft of hair like this. This is not from this patient. I have other pictures. I don't think I put it here. But tuft of hair could be one. So when you see a child like that, particularly it was not a congenital one, acquired one, always think. And for this particular child, you can see there was a spina bifida with, you can see the continuity with the cord. Or a dimple. And this child with the dimple, you can see there is a, not only this, there's a tethering of the cord and it goes in here, or just a swelling like this. It's a pat of fat or lipoma, and that should be also indication of a spina bifida occulta. It is not necessarily, it has to be only in the lumbar spine. It can be in the dorsal spine. This child came with a swelling. He can, sorry, the hair is there, it can't cover, you can't see. She came with a swelling in the neck. And she had, if you see the MRI, you can see a diastematomyelia. You could see also that the swelling was extending here, and this child had a spina bifida occulta in the cervical area. This is a spina bifida manifesta, which of course you will not miss it. But if you see the MRI of this child, you can see that there is also associated cord lesion. So spina bifida occulta can have a cord lesion with the tethering of the cord, which will give a problem much later, or it could be spinal cord, internal cord lesion like diastematomyelia or things like that. Patient can present with the weakness, which will cause the equinovarus deformity. So this is very, very important. Hyperpigmentation, not all hyperpigmentations are abnormal. This is what's a blue spot. This is a harmless one. It is called a Mongolian superspot. It's not only in Mongolian. You can have seen quite a bit of in Indians too. Not very common, but not uncommon at all. This is quite an innocuous, harmless one. You don't have to worry about that. Coming to palpation, of course, like any other area, if you have a localized prioritization, you can look for a warmth and tenderness. But more important, you must look at the, you should know how to know which level it is. That's number one. Then you do routine one, look at the iliac crest, joining a draw a line joining both the top of the iliac, both the iliac crest is between L4, L5. So you will know where, which level you are. Or you join both the posterior superior iliac spine, that is S2. So you know where you are. Then palpate all the circular, the lumbosacral junction, spinous processes. You might find a step there. Secular joints, you should never miss it. Of course, you will do it later, but at the same time, you can look for tenderness and look for spasm of the paraspinal muscle. And how do you look for tenderness is another common question the examiners like. The direct one, pressure on the spinous process, that can elicit the pain. If not, you can give a rotational stress. You press by the side of the spinous process and give a rotational stress, and that is will produce a specific pain. And more common in tuberculosis like that. And deep thrust tenderness, a very mild lesion, you may not get by this. So you can do a gentle percussion, but please remember that you should be gentle, not go on hammering there. Amyl test, we always suggest not to do, but you should know what it is, and I'm sure all of you know how it is done. It is not to be done. It's only if you are asked, you tell about it. You do it only when you are sure that there is no problem in the cervical spine. Now, other than that, when you look for the tenderness, also look for the spasm, secular joint, and step sign. A step sign deformity, all of you know, is indicative of spondylolisthesis. You run your finger down the lumbar spine, a palpable step at the lumbosacral junction, if it is L5-S1, that will show you a spondylolisthesis. Twist can also be found in a patellar dislocation. These are all the beginning ones. Then I come to the movements. The movements here are very, very important because that really is something which is not easy to do, unlike other areas, because here also you have to do active and passive. Quite often in the exam, you do only active. We are happy, we don't ask, but if it's relevant, you particularly at a higher level, we insist. So you should know there is a passive range of movement also. In active range of movement, I think you know all the movements, flexion, extension, lateral flexion, most of you don't do, and a rotation. We'll tell you how to do everything. The picture showing that. And how do you measure? A measurement in other joints, you can do eyeballing or a goniometer. Here also you can do that. But when we usually talk about flexion, we talk about the distance from the fingertip to the floor. That's one method. If that is not possible, also, suppose patient is going to be far away from the floor, then you can see up to what level. Keep the hand down at what level. If it comes up to the mid-thigh or a patella, you can say like that. And you must remember, just because patient is not able to bend, it doesn't mean that it is only at the spinal problem. If you've got a very tight hamstrings also, bending will be affected. Even a very tight gastrocnemius also, the bending will be difficult. And of course, in paraspinal spasm. Extension is looking backwards. Be careful. Patient should not fall down. Again, you hear, you say about approximately how much you are able to see the extension. Like if you see the picture, you can say patient has got a normal extension. Lateral flexion bending, you ask the patient to slide the finger down and touch the as low, much low as possible on the leg. So it will go along the side of the thigh, along the leg. For example, if a patient is able to do only up the knee joint line or middle of the leg, that's how we are going to look. For rotation, patient must be made to sit and stabilize the pelvis and the legs, and without turning the neck, ask the patient to look. That's what you are looking. You are not looking at the rotation of cervical spine, looking at the dorsal spine, dorsal lumbar area. And most important, patient should be able to rotate equally on both sides. Now, if some examiners, may I ask you that, can you use the goniometer? The biggest problem with this is that this is not, if you are going to say 10 degrees more or less, none of us are going to punish you or anything for that. It's all right. But you should know how to use the goniometer. People are not used. They will go with the goniometer. They will not know where to keep the fulcrum, how to align. That is the position. And that again comes from practice. So unless surveys you routinely use, at least not in the OPD, at least in the ward when you write, then if you do for 10 patients, the 11th time it will come to you normally. So example, if the lateral bending, you can see here, this is the fulcrum, this is the fulcrum of your goniometer, align it over the S1 spinous process. How do you make out? As I told you, you draw a line in the PSIS, that is S2, the one spine above that. So keep it there. Then you have two arms. This is the stationary arm. Stationary arm is the midline, what we call the median sacral crest in the between the gluteal area. So that is the area where you keep the stationary arm. This is the one it will move. If the patient was straight, this movement arm of the goniometer would have been here. So it has moved by, let's say, 30 degrees. And that is how you will measure. And the next one is about the rotation. For the rotation, where do you keep the fulcrum? On the center of the head. Then, where do you keep the stationary arm? Stationary arm will be parallel to the iliac crest. And the movement arm will be in a line along with the acromion process. This could be reversed. For some reason, you are not able to do that, or your goniometer, both are mobile, then you can reverse it. It doesn't make a difference, but the stationary arm should be something where you are easy to locate, like the medial crest. So this is the way. Similarly, you should be able to be comfortably doing with the goniometer. That is what is important. So this is all you are helping the patient. Patient is going to do actively. And passive range of movements, it is not a must in the exam, because really you won't have time for that. You should know. But if the examiner asks, then, because by, for example, now active means patient is able to do. Suppose patient is not able to do active, you want to know whether the movements are not there or not, you have to do passive. So as it is, I'll show you in the thing, but it's, you make the patient lie down, flex both the knees and try to bring the knees to the chest. That is how you are going to extend. Flex. For extension, put the patient prone and press the pelvis down and lift up the legs. That is extension. Lateral flexion, etc. Similarly, you have to do that. For example, here, you can see for the passive flexion, you are bringing the knees to the chest, and that is the extension. Patient is lying down, press the pelvis down, and for lateral rotation, make the patient lie down straight and you take the knee and the thigh in your hand and try to rotate the spine. So that is the passive flexion. In fact, there is one more movement that is called resisted movements, which you don't need. Coming to measurements, one of the commonest thing the examiners ask is the Schober's test. And if we go into details of Schober's test, we can probably spend 1 hour on that, because there are at least 3 to 4 modifications of Schober's test. So I'm not going to take that much time, but I will just tell you Schober's test because it is asked. Chest expansion, please don't forget, irrespective of whether it is a hip joint case, spine case, chest expansion. It's also a movement. Common question asked to use, if it's a movement, which joint is it? It's the costovertebral joints. Somebody said the other day, costochondral, even that slip of the tongue shouldn't happen. There's no movement there. It's a costovertebral joint movement. Limb length, it's not a part of the spine, but there could be a difference in limb length due to any other cause. So if your time permits, or if you at least do a fast limb length measurement also too, it may be safer for you. Now, Schober's test. What is the Schober's test? It actually assesses the amount of lumbar flexion. So it is actually a method of measuring the movement only, but it comes under a measurement. So how do you do that? So why is this important? Actually speaking, when you are asking the patient to touch the floor, it's not entirely in the spine. He can do something, some extent on the hip flexion. So you want to measure exactly how much objectively, how much you're taking spine in the spine and not in the other joints. So there are two methods. As I told you, the original Schober's, we are not using. The other modification, if I remember vaguely, is by Folkman. What we actually should be pronouncing Folkman. And that's the one, then there are so many, as I said, I'm not going to do that. So the difference is only in marking the points. One, you first mark the midpoint or the medial, you know the medial, there the medial, median, sacral crest, cleft, so you mark that. And you mark the dimple of Venus. Temple of Venus is easily palpable, but seen easily visible even in thin individuals. So if it is marked, temple of Venus one side, temple of Venus one side, and you have marked as a midline. From this line, 5 centimeters below, in alignment with this, mark the one point. From this line, 15 centimeters above, you make 10 centimeters above, you make another line. So this is totally 15 centimeters. Now, another, suppose the dimple of Venus is not seen, then what do you do? Then you can look at the posterior superior iliac spine. So look at the posterior superior spine, mark it on the right side, mark it on the left side, draw a line joining them, and take another point in the midline, 5 centimeters below, 10 centimeters above. So except that one is dimple of Venus and other one is PSIS, there is no difference. Now, after you did all the marking, then ask the patient to bend down as much as possible. After he bends down the maximum, measure the distance. Normally, so this should be 15 now. If it is more than 21 centimeters, then the spinal flexion is normal. So there should be at least minimum 6 centimeters. So suppose the patient has only 4 centimeters of movement, then there is a restriction of spinal flexion. So this is one of the tests commonly, particularly when you suspect an ankylosing spondylitis, where the lumbar spine movements restriction is one of the findings. This is very, very useful test. So this is the one of the things. If this doesn't mean that you should not measure the total spine. Along with this, you know the most prominent cervical vertebrae. You can put a tape there, put another tape in the S1, which you already marked out. Ask the patient to bend forward, whole spine movements you can measure. But this is much more easier. And just to tell you, actually I was planning not to tell that, there's also something like a digital brain, a digital Schauber's, but it's not very reliable, so I don't suggest, I don't tell you. Now, at this stage, you come to neurology. And when you do the neurology, you can start with the straight leg raising test, because that is the most important thing. Then go to neurology, and at the end, you can do the rectal examination after getting the permission of the examiner and the patient in the exam setting. And otherwise, if you are examining a patient in your ward, you should do a rectal examination. So neurology, I think all of you know. I'll come to SLR later, because that you can take a low straight leg raising test alone. We can have for 1 or 2 hours. So let's see how much time we get on that. So at least 5 to 10 minutes we need for that. So you have to examine the upper limb. Just because your problem is in the lower limb, please do not leave the upper limb. At least do as much short examination as possible as the time permits. So the steps are inspection. Some things are seen, like for an upper motor neuron, you can see the contraction of the muscles. Inspection, tone, power, superficial reflexes, deep reflexes, and coordination. I have to go fast here because one, you will be knowing all this is very basic. And I know I want to save my time for the straight leg raising test. And tone, I think all of you know, it is increased, what we call hypertonia. It can be in the lesions of premolar tract producing spasticity, or lesions of extrapyramidal tract producing rigidity. And in a low motor neuron, it will be flaccid. And when you do the thing, before you do individual muscles when indicated, do as a group so that you know go fast, so shoulder, and you should know the root value. This, the best is that you can make a chart, put it in your classroom. So whenever you get to have a look at it, or use the chart to keep examining the patients, then it will stay in your mind. So you will test for the shoulder, adduction, abduction, other movements too. I'm just giving, going fast, elbow flexion extension, wrist flexion extension, all the hand, all those things, you do it. And you should, along with that, doing that, write the value, particularly in your examining the patient in the ward. That's the best time. You have time. Do the test, even if it is a, let me say the patient is a case of a scoliosis, then you don't have anything to worry. It's a dorsal spine, you have nothing to worry about the cervical spine. Do that, there also do all the upper limbs and write down. So you will remember how to do and what will be the value. Reflexes, superficial and deep. Again, I'm going fast in that. You know about all the superficial reflexes. Biceps, deep reflexes, bicep jerk, tricep jerk, supinator jerk. Supinator jerk is a very common favorite question of the examiners. So again, know the root value and how to do it. There are different methods of grading of reflexes. There are, to my knowledge, 3 to 4. You follow whichever you know. It is difficult for me to know all the different gradings. Unlike a muscle power by MRC grading 1 to 5, there is nothing similar here. So this is something which I like. I find it simple. I won't say simple, find it easy, because it starts with 0 and then a 0.5. All are plus only. Reflex which is elicited with reinforcement, and a low reflex, that is a 1+, normal reflex is 2+, when it becomes brisk 3+, very brisk is 4+, and 5 is a sustained clonus. But there are others like this given. Anything, whichever you follow is fine, but no, you should know there is a different method, there's a definite method of looking. This is not that reflex is present and absent, that alone is not enough. Even in not only exam point of view, because you should never miss a clonus. Babinski test, I am not going to tell you how to do it, what is the importance. That will be even I am sure even the first year student will know. But please do remember that it is common in the newborn, but it should cease quickly after birth. So if you are going to find it later, it is definitely important. Then comes to the sensory things. Again, you should know if it is going to be a C5 root, where will be the lat, where, which area will be involved. One easy way, not totally correct, if you are going to deltoid area, it is C5, then you are going to the lateral part of the forearm is C6. So you remember like this, examine every patient like this, 10 patients, 11th patient will come into your mind. So you should have a chart like that. And when you touch sensation, you should know what all you have to test. In an OPD setting, you can't do all that. But even in examination, you ask for a hot water and a cold water for testing when a test tube. Examiner says, don't bother, then you are lucky, don't bother. But you should know, a light touch and a pinprick or a sharp touch, temperature, proprioception is very important, vibration, two-point discrimination. So you should do all that. If time doesn't permit, do what you can. Tell the examiner, I wanted to, but time didn't allow me. So this is for the lower limb. Just like the upper limb, the first is the tone, then the power, again, hip, knee, ankle, you should know. Particularly if you are common thing, if you have a disc lesion with a foot drop, examiners are likely to keep it. So you will definitely ask, you will be asked what is the root level for ankle jerk, et cetera, or what is the power of the ankle plantar flexors, et cetera, what is the level. So please, you must keep these charts and keep, as I said, either remember it or see it every day or do it every day. How to do the reflexes? You have to do it because you shouldn't miss it. I'm not going to go into that. Similarly, sensory. This is something which you put your hand into the pocket, that is going to be where your hand is going to be there. It has L1. Similarly, you must remember each one. L2 is anterior thigh. And if you are going to the medial side of the leg is L4, lateral side is L5. So that should come into your mind. Otherwise, put a picture like this in your this thing and keep looking at every day, so that at least will go into your mind. Coming to special tests, there are special tests for spine also. It is not only a sight-lacing test, but invariably, your examination setting and even in the practical, the commonest thing we do is a straight-lacing test, so that I will go a little bit more into detail. A straight-leg raising test is purpose is to look for a nerve root irritation or a root tension. Now, that's what is very, very important. That is the idea behind it. It is not that we are looking for a disc lesion. We are looking for root irritation or a root tension. This picture already I put for you. I will not go. There are some precocytes. There should be no exaggerated lumbar lordosis. Then there should be a normal mobile hip. If you can't move the hip, then where's the question? There should not be FFD. If there's a 40-degree FFD, SLR is going to start from 40-degree. If there is a hamstring spasm, then when you are doing the SLR, that will be causing the pain. And the last is, if you don't have an intelligent and a cooperative patient, it may be a little difficult. The last hope should not happen for your examination, because usually such patients are not kept. So you first thing is that whenever we talk straight leg raising test, it's always meant for the spine. The others, when you, for example, for sometime in the hip, you are asking the patient to lift the leg straight. That is totally different. That is not called like that. Here it is a passive one. Patient is not asked. Patient is going to lie down. you are going to lift up the leg. So first do on one side, the knee should be straight. Start taking it up. When the patient experiences a pain, which is along the thigh, gluteal region, calf, etc., or what is troubling him, if you are thinking that's the root pain, then that is what is problem. That is where the pain comes in. So see, for example, you have come to 60 degree, the pain occurs, you make a note, but it doesn't really mean that there is a root tension. At this level, that is where the pain starts. Now you must do a striatic stress test to know whether there is a tension in the root. That is the second part. So there are many ways of doing it. You can come to the area where the pain starts, stop there, do a dorsiflexion of the foot. And if that is painful, then or there's an additional pain, that is a positive straight lacing test. Other than this, there are many other methods of doing that, what I just now told you. And before coming to the other methods, okay, I already told you at 60 degree you have a pain, that doesn't mean root tension. Why? Because even simple, if there is a problem of some of the muscles in the gluteal area, a myogenic problem, that also painful. The ischial bursitis, that will be painful. It will produce pain at that area when you flex so much. Or there's an annular tear or a hamstring weak tightness, all including herniated disc will be positive. Only when you prove by a sciatic stretch touch that is applicable to the nerve root. So what are the methods of doing that? Second thing, even before you left, the patient is a malingerer. Moment you touch the leg and going to try to lift it, it's hardly 0 to 2 degrees, he starts telling of pain, then probably either there is some other cause. It is not a dysplasia, maybe there's a hip joint pathology, or there is acute ischial bursitis, something like that. So don't think if SLR is going to be just as you start. You should look for other causes. Now, there are many methods of doing that. So these are commonly asked. So that's why I'm going to spend time on that. One of the maneuver, other than whatever you called it, that is the Braggart test. When you, what you do, that you have SLR positive, slightly lower it and do a dorsiflexion, and that is the Braggart test, or what is called a modified Lasygase test, where you keep the patient supine, flex the hip and knee to 90 degrees and gradually extend the knee, which will produce the pain. Here the advantage is that it's no more a hip pathology because you are reducing it, so it's not from the hip, it is from the sciatic tension. There are others like Koenig's test, Brudzinski's test. All of are evaluating the nerve root tension. So coming to the first one, we will come to Brudzinski's test first. This Brudzinski is a Joseph Brudzinski. He is the picture there. He's a Polish man. He is the pediatrician, basically. Pediatrician. And he died at a very young age of 43. He had described almost 4 or 5 things, including this. So what he described was that same thing, supine, perform a unilateral SLR. When the pain occurs, flex the knee so the pain disappears, then flex the neck. So that is how he described. A little modification of that is the Koenig's, where so this is the picture for showing the Brudzinski's, and the bowstring sign is the one which I find comparatively easier, more relevant, more easy, because you are holding the leg, your hands are free, you don't have to go to the next side or something like that. So here is, you first come to the area where the pain starts, flex the knee. When the flex the knee, the pain should disappear because you have no more tension. Put your hand on the popliteal area in the midline where the nerve should be traveling. Stretch the nerve. That's you have a bow and a string, and you press the sciatic nerve. It will provocate symptoms. Quite reliable one. And most important, this removes hamstring as a cause of pain. So that is one of the importance of a bowstring try. The second part, which is probably what is more important than all these different methods, all the methods are ideally or finally coming to same conclusion. What is important is when you do this, when you start raising the leg, unaffected side gets the pain. That is called cross SLR. That is going to be very, very important because a SLR is very sensitive, but it's not specific. Whereas a crossed SLR is very specific, but sensitivity is low. This is there in many articles published in the literature. Now, SLR, I got a sensitivity of 91%, but specificity is only 32%. That means if you get 100 positive, only 32 may be disc. All others have been some other cause. But if you want to rule out, then SLR is better. Because SLR is negative, then there is a chance that 91% it is non-disc. So SLR is very useful in ruling out disc herniation. The crossed SLR is very sensitive, very specific, 98% specific. That is, if you get a crossed SLR, you can be 98% sure it is a disc, but you may get positive only in 32% of patients. So it is for confirming is good is the crossed SLR, ruling out better with the straight leg raising test. There are one more modification of this called seated SLR. You make the patient sit in the edge of the bed, knee and the hip placed, extend the knee slowly without letting the thigh come off the thing. One hand of yours keeps the thigh on the chair, other one bring the knee. What patient will arch back, extend both the arms, and he has pain below the knee, indicates sciatic pain. So do both. You can do a sitting SLR and a supine SLR, correlate. If both correlates, then it is a true one. Otherwise, patient is probably a malinger. So, there are certain tests for, quite often, particularly if you are working with workmen who have some compensatory benefits, they come, they know all these things, they also know. So, how do you look for it? For example, you have reduced the thing, instead of dorsiflexing, plantar flex it. Opposite, he should get relief, but he will complain of severe pain, then he's a malingerer. Then there's Hoover test, somebody might ask you, what do you do? There, you catch the heel of the patient like a cup in the hand, ask him to raise the weak leg. He should put downward pressure on the normal side, because that is how he gets the force. If he doesn't do that, he is malingering. Waddell has described Waddell's signs, which is for malingering. One, it will be non-anatomic. Even if you pinch the skin, he'll tell back pain. You do axial loading, he'll combine back here pain. You distract a patient, make him sit, there'll be difference. And pain will not follow any route. And you are touched for power, he will not do the contraction at all. These five things were described by Waddell. All this I'm telling because sometimes some examiners do ask you. This is all for the roots, which is in the sciatic area. If it is along the, if it's a L1 or L2 or L3 root, it will be along the femoral nerve. So it is a different area. How do you do that? It is put the patient prone and passively flex the knee and lift up the thigh. That is, other words, you are looking for extension of the hip. Put the patient, passively flex the knee to try comfortably hold, and then lift up the thigh so that you are doing extension. This is one, elicits a pressure. It also is called the femoral stretch test. So for example, if you have a hemophilia patient, there's a tuberous hematoma pressing upon the femoral nerve, this test is positive. Or you have a disc prolapse at L2, L3 level, then also this will be positive. So it's called the femoral stretch test. And this is something which in those cases should be done. At this stage, if you thought your diagnosis was tuberculosis, you didn't look for the cold abscess, go for that. Or you think that you had looking for a neurology and you want to know about the bladder bowel signs, you do a rectal examination and you know what to look for that. You can look for the contraction and perineal sensation. And lastly, look for peripheral pulses. If sometime they also can mask mimic a radiculopathy or canal stenosis. So you have finished the clinical examination. Before you think of diagnosis, summarize your neurology. Is it upper motor regulation, lower motor regulation? What is the neurology level? What is the motor level? What is sensory level, reflexes level? So your final neurological level is the highest one. That is the spinal level. What will be the corresponding vertebra? Spinal cord ends at L1. Corresponding vertebra, again, you know that is the bony level. So in the neurology, your neurology level, spinal level, vertebral level, then you come to the diagnosis. When you say the diagnosis, if all your findings put into one diagnosis, fine. But otherwise, if you want to say tuberculosis spine with cord compression, and what is the neurology level? So that's how you say. But there, but anyway, that is clinical examination is over. This part is not beyond that. But sometimes you have a classical case, there's a low back pain, pain in the legs, a unilateral or a bilateral lower limb motor sensory abnormality, got a bowel bladder function, and you did a parietal, there's a like loss of anal tone and sensation. It's a cauda equina. So there you can straight away say cauda equina, it's not necessary. But otherwise, when you are not able to say that, particularly where you're not able to come to a diagnosis, then you can give it like this. And there ends your clinical examination. The rest of the things are all theory. So I'll stop at this level and open for questions. Thank you so much. Thanks for listening.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Rajagopalan. I think we'll have a few questions as it's almost 55 minutes.
Oh, yes, I'm so sorry, John.
It's difficult to stop once you get
going. I did not know at all, John. Absolutely. In fact, I was asked, planned to ask Janki in between to remind me. I got.
Well, I think he sent you some reminders in the chat, but.
I'm extremely sorry. This.
No, don't worry about that. We have some time for questions, so let's.
Yeah.
Sure. We can have.
Yes, sir. So, first question is from Amit, sir. He want to know what is the anatomical terms we mean by upper and lower motor neuron lesion.
What is the anatomical term? Okay, anything which involves the peripheral nerves is a lower motor neuron lesion or below that. And anything which involves the cord, the basically, I'm just trying to put it as simple as possible. So, if you take the anatomy, so you have the spinal cord, you have anterior horn cells, from there peripheral nerve comes and goes into your motor neuron junction in the muscle. So from the anterior horn, anything coming down up to this thing, it is a lower motor neuron lesion. Anything from the anterior horn inclusive to anything up to the brain, that's upper motor neuron lesion. If that is what you are meaning, that's what you mean.
So, sir, yeah, anterior horn cell lesion is called wrong. Upper motor neuron.
Yeah, no, I think that's probably very accurate because a lower motor neuron would be anything beyond the, and anything superior which includes the pyramidal tracts, etc., would be considered as an upper motor neuron.
For your example, if for the student's sake, if you have poliomyelitis, which you're not a, thankfully, it's not a much of a problem, now involves the anterior horn cell. So, it is an upper motor neuron lesion that you must remember like that. If it is involved in the root, then it's a different one. Sorry. A poliomyelitis involves the anterior horn cell, so it is a lower motor neuron. Sorry.
Yeah, anything
anything above that is upper motor neuron. Sorry.
So, another question from Kumar Gautam. He want to know about the paraspinal muscle spasm. Is inspectory finding or a palpatory finding?
Okay. What I meant is, it is better seen than felt. That's all I meant. You can definitely palpate. You put the hand on the muscle, a flaccid muscle, you know. Spasm muscle will be hard. You can definitely palpate. But even without palpation, you will see the muscle standing out, particularly if the patient is muscular and not obese. But it can be palpated. It's a palpatory finding and an inspection finding. In a thin individual, it is better seen than felt. There are two things which are better seen than felt. One is that other one also muscle is spasm. Other one is wasting. Even though we measure, your measuring tape may miss 1 millimeter. Your eyes will not miss. That's the great thing about the eyes. Yeah, wasting is better seen. Similarly, muscle spasm is better seen in those who are thin and muscular. But it is
so both. I think what you would say in your inspection is probably prominence of the muscles, and then confirm it in your palpation to say it's spasm. Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
But you can probably see it better, but you need to confirm it by
palpation.
So another question from Gautam is that is a scoliosis Alter Sober's test?
Ah, that's a very good question. See, even if the scoliosis alters the Sober's test, your movements is altered. It doesn't, cause doesn't matter. Suppose the, if the, let me say your movement of the lumbar spine affected by a deformity is still a lost. Of course, scoliosis, if it is affecting the lumbar spine, if they're deformed, movements will be affected, but Sober's test is still remains the Sober's test. Your cause will be here, not ankylosing spondylitis. It will be scoliosis. That's all. But if scoliosis, cervical scoliosis, spine scoliosis, that will not affect the lumbar spine.
Yeah, and also relatively, the movements are not lost in scoliosis as compared to ankylosing spondylosis. So you will, yeah. So it'll the classical Sober's test is where there's almost no movement between the vertebral spines, so you get hardly any increase in the distance between the lumbar vertebra when you flex the spine. While in scoliosis, you'll still get some
movements.
Yes.
Yeah. It should be performed in case of a scoliosis, sir, no?
Exactly. Yeah, you can do a Sober's test because you can have both pathologies there in a patient. Yeah.
So okay. Another question asked by him is how to clinically differentiate between spasticity and rigidity.
Okay, I was not going into that because again the time, the clasp knife rigidity, and see the thing is cogwheel rigidity. I think you know a clasp knife, you know, a cogwheel rigidity. It will get a like a cogwheel. It goes stop. So when you do a see, how do you look for? Let me say, you keep a hand. Ask the patient to drop the hand. So there, it's not only that you do the flexion extension. You can also ask the drop. If the rigidity is throughout, it is called the clasp rigidity. If when it is come stop, that is cogwheel rigidity. Now the clasp rigidity is common in the your pyramidal symptoms. And whereas the other one is common in the extrapyramidal symptom. So that is called spasticity. This is called rigidity.
One doubt usually during the exam when marking the spinal process, where to mark all spinous process to be marked, or there is some specific point which should be marked?
If you are going to talk about a scoliosis, I mean,
not in scoliosis, sir, in general,
you
while examining,
marking,
sir.
Yeah, while examining, for example, let me say that you are counting the spine. Let me say that you are got a gibbous at, say, D5, D6. Then you should know how you calculate it. So you mark out the most prominent vertebrae so that you know where you are calculating. Or if you want to look at the lumbar spine, you mark out the top of the iliac crest, draw a line. Then you mark the lumbar spine above that line. So you have got the L4 now. So you know above that is L3, L2, L1. So my lesion is in L1. Or if you are doing a Sober's test. Otherwise, if it is not a scoliosis, it's only if there's a relevant finding for that. Like you have a step, then you have to mark it out. Otherwise, not necessary. This is what I know. Because this is not a settled uncommon question. So this is what I practically think. John, so please feel free to add. They should not get a wrong information. So feel free to add.
No, it's okay. These, I think, unfortunately, some of this is examiner's quirks. Okay.
Yes, I agree. Totally. I agree. Yeah. Sometimes we learn from these questions.
Sir, another question is that if patient is having gibbous, should we examine him in supine position, means in lying down position only, or we can allow him to stand?
Okay. See, it's like this. Two things are there. Whatever, you know, no harm come to the patient. If patient is in severe pain, they're only in lying down position, number one. If the gibbous is there, patient is comfortable, no pain, they can examine both the positions. Let me say healed fracture or healed tuberculosis, with come with the internal gibbous and the thing, then fine. There's no harm done.
Yeah, I think if he can sit up or stand up, then you can do it in that.
And painless.
He's having severe pain and spasm, you don't want to do that. Yeah.
But the important thing in the exam is that as an examiner, I don't like to see somebody in the exam tension, you forget. You do what is painful to the patient. Our patient starts crying. You feel extremely bad. So that is one thing. You don't have to do anything which is going to be harmful or painful to the patient as much as possible.
So about the like in hip examination also, it is mentioned that parietal examination to be done. It is in spine examination also, we should have to do parietal examination, sir, in all cases or at least to ask.
Yes, in a spine examination, a parietal examination is very, very important. The only thing is, in the examination setting, that's why I'm telling you, you don't admit a spine patient without doing a parietal examination, but all other rules and regulations are important. Have a female bystander if it's a female. Take the consent of the patient today. Don't take any patient for granted. See that there is one more person with you. All those things, leaving aside, it should be done. In the examination, please ask one of the skilled assistant or the examiner. Suppose they ask me, I decide if particular patient is not necessary, don't do it. Unless indicated, we don't. Suppose there is no positive finding in that, I never ask them to do. But answer is yes, you are supposed to do spinal parietal examination. But please ask in the examination setting because you are in another place.
In terms of importance, it's probably more important in the spine than the hip.
Yes, 100%.
For doing a PR because more likely to have neurological problems. Okay. Having said that, in an exam setting, I think you need to check because I'm especially these days a lot of people for the exams they say avoid the PR exam. So I think it would be examiner dependent, but in terms of actual. To say that you'll do it in hip and not do it in spine is quite the contrary. I would rather do it in spine than do it in hip.
Actually, in hip, you know, I never insist. In fact,
exactly. So yeah, because in most hip pathologies, you wouldn't do it normally. Yeah.
Yeah.
In spine, a lot of them you would do it. Yeah? Especially if there's any neurological involvement, then I think that is important part of it, of your examination.
Then, sir, in exam, sir, what is ideal, sir? Do a PR or not to do a PR? And ask.
That's what we just discussed, that you need to check if the examiners or like whoever's the assisting guy, check with them whether you are allowed or supposed to do a PR. They might tell you not to. But in a spine case, on your own, you should always think of doing a PR.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
And in a hip, may not be in an elbow or a knee, but for a spine, I think it's
important. Yes.
Yes. So, if someone is not doing PR also, but it is important to know what is important when someone is doing PR. So, what all points, because that can be asked in the Viva.
Yeah. See, very good question. Now, the thing is like this. Quite often, sometimes in an exam setting, there may not be a privacy or something, or patient maybe tomorrow also kept for exam. If you do today, tomorrow they will not come. Whatever the reason, we don't let you do. The first thing is that first thing you should look at is the tone of the muscle. Whether when you put your finger, you will realize whether the perineal muscles are contracting or not. Next, you look at the sensation. Then, of course, if you want to do the pinprick test and looking for the contraction, etc., that also you can do. But the loss of tone and sensation, that is the most important thing.
And also, I mean, the PR is not complete without actually looking for any swelling, any lumps,
yes, etc. Yes, that's true. But
once you do it, you have to do everything. That's the problem. So I would hope that the examiner tells you not to do it.
Sir, the last question. That I want to just
know. It's also important to know what position you'll do the PR in.
Yeah.
Okay. Also important, like he mentioned already, is to take permission, explain to the patient what you're going to do. Make sure you're wearing gloves which are adequately lubricated so that you don't cause any pain. Okay. And then do it very sort of methodically, as you mentioned, feel the tone, feel the sensation, then only do any further examination. If it's painful, then you may have to stop and say that it was painful, so I didn't do it. Or the patient doesn't cooperate, then you can say that patient was not cooperating for me to do a PI.
Refuse.
They can refuse, so that's
the patient. That's the important thing. I think that is very, very important. Today, consent is extremely important.
The last question about the exposure of the patient when we are examining for a male patient, what we can do?
For a male patient, we
exposure,
give a...
Exposure, sir.
Exposure, no? Yeah, we give a tip bandage for the male patients. Usually, there is particularly, as John knows, in Pondicherry, we don't have problem with that when we conduct the exam, if it's a national board or local exam. Female is a problem. It depends on the area. So, to be very frank, I will always choose the patient because it shouldn't be troublesome for the student. That is the most important. Patient is not cooperative, he will suffer. So I avoid the female patients where you need, for example, even spine, sometimes it has to be completely, except for a T-bandage, you have to expose the scoliosis for that matter. So it's like this, that male patient, a T-bandage, female patient, as much as possible, you can do with a T-bandage and a chest cover. But we have patients who will understand it. That is clear, particularly in a different level. I used to conduct FNB exam regularly in St. John's. I was the only person conducting in the beginning. The only St. John's was the only center. We used to keep and tell the patient, and they used to understand. Sometimes we used to give them a vest like a bunion. They can still palpate. But answer is T-bandage. The males.
So, thank you so much, sir. And most of the questions we have covered, sir. And
I think that's great. Thank you very much, Dr. Rajgopal. It's a pleasure to catch up again after many years.
Thank you, John. So nice to see you. It's very difficult to do that. You know.
It's. I think one of the good things about the sort of lockdown or the corona or COVID is that at least we meet people on Zoom who we otherwise would not meet at all.
You are very true. So I was hoping that from this year, at least we can reduce the webinar and go to some physical, but looks like we have to keep it for some more time.
Yeah, but there's some meetings which have started, but you have to be really cautious about it. You can't be careful about it at all.
I am the chairman of the PG committee. So I had stopped the PG teaching, thinking we'll start live. Now I have taken a backseat on that because it is going up everywhere. From March, we are having in tie-up with JBJS through Mumbai, the Wadia Hospital, through Dr. Rujita. And we are having lectures for the postgraduates, mainly how to do a research study, how to review literature, how to get a grant like that. Once a month, a person from the JBJS, they are going to talk. So I think we'll have to stick with the webinar for some more time because it's becoming bad.
Okay, great. So thank you very much. And
thanks, John.
Whenever we catch up.
Thank
again.
You so much, sir.
Thanks to all of you. Thanks to everybody there on the side. Thank you, Janki. I hope I'm extremely sorry, John. I just lost the...
No, it's okay. I think probably you didn't see the reminders on chat. You should have probably said it vocally, but you didn't want to disturb you. Great.
I'm sorry.
No, it's fine.
But it keeps happening again and again. I'm sorry. Anyway.
Enthusiasm. Okay. Fine.
Okay.
Okay.
Bye. Bye. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Bye.